Very good morning to all. It's been a very pleasant weather at Coimbatore for the last 1 week, and I hope everyone is enjoying the weather and staying safe. Thank you everyone for joining the session, both in person and online. Well, we all know that in addition to our research interest and technical domains, we need to gain knowledge in several other cross-functional domains. It is important that we should be able to collaborate within the department, across departments and across institutions for multidisciplinary projects. Therefore, it is essential that we need to be proficient in people skills and soft skills when we grow in the career ladder. There are two ways of gaining knowledge. One is by reading textbooks and another is by listening to expert lectures in that particular field and topic. Thiruvalluvar had said that Selvathul Selvam Sevichelvam Achelvam Selvathul Ellam Thalai, meaning Seviyal Ketarim Selvam Selvangal Ellavachilalum Thalayanadakum. I am sure everyone will agree that it is always easy to learn the nuances when someone is explaining and demonstrating things for us instead of learning from textbooks. Kalvi vaayilaga arivai perum muyarchiyai vida kelvi vaayilaga arivai ezhidhilum koodudhalagavum peralam. Therefore, we need to plan and attend lot of talks and lectures in order to keep ourselves updated in this competitive world. Due to pandemic situation, we have been missing the pleasure of listening to the lectures and technical talks in person. Almost all events, including co-curricular events, are conducted in online mode during the last 10 months. Nevertheless, today we have the pleasure of listening to the lecture on personal and professional ethics by Dr. L.S. Ganesh, retired professor of IIT Madras, Department of Management Studies, which is fondly called as DOMS among IITM community. நல்லாரை காண்பதும் நன்றே, நலமிக்க நல்லார் சொல் கேட்பதும் நன்றே, நல்லார் குணங்கள் உரைப்பதும் நன்றே, அவரோடு இணங்கி இருப்பதும் நன்று. நல்லவர்களை காண்பதும் நமக்கு பயன் நன்மை பயக்கும் சொல்லை கேட்பதும் அவர்களோடு சேர்ந்து இருப்பதும் நல்லது. On behalf of the PhD ITech management, faculty members and students, I take immense pleasure in welcoming our guest speaker, Professor Dr. L. Ganesh, who is going to share his knowledge, wisdom and experience on personal and professional ethics today. Ability is the what we are capable of doing. Motivation determines what we do. Our attitude determines how well we do it. Also, we need to do what is right, not what is easy and what is popular. Both our principal and vice principal lead us by their actions, doing things themselves in all possible initiatives. I request our vice principal, Dr. Chandramohan, who is very straightforward in telling things in the right perspective, to formally welcome the gathering and give his prelude to the session by setting up the stage for today's talk.
Very good morning to all of you. As Dr. Manimayalai was telling, we have a very pleasant weather, pleasant morning to all of you. We are very, very happy to welcome the chief guest, Dr. L.S. Ganesh. Let us give big hands in welcoming the chief guest. He is not new to our campus. He has visited many times to PhD ITech, well-wisher of PhD institutions. And in fact, the right topic, the right person. That's the one word that I would like to say. Ethics, from faculty's point of view, as well as from students' point of view, faculty, our main role is teaching, and we have to handle the classes to our best ability and see that we handle all the classes to the best of our knowledge. Regarding students, now all first year students are in online mode, a very challenging task. You're all listening now. You're going to write the examination also through online mode. Here a big challenge comes as far as writing exam is concerned, even attending class is concerned. I request our students to be present physically, then you can switch on your video or you can be there in Zoom or Google Meet. If you are not able to listen to lecture, you can leave the meeting. It may be Zoom or Google. Don't bother about attendance. So be sincere. We want you to reflect your ethics. Regarding examination also, Don't worry about marks. You be sincere. See that you don't try to indulge in any form of malpractice. We are here to help you to conduct any number of retests. And see that we will be helping you in coaching also. So we want you to demonstrate the best ethical practice. That is what ITEC also needs. And we have the chief guest, Dr. L.S. Ganesh. In fact, I don't want to describe about his teaching ability. He'll be demonstrating it. He will be showing the emotions. In fact, when Devasena was contacting Dr. L.S. Ganesh, he wanted to meet the students in face-to-face mode. But due to restrictions by the government, we are not able to permit the students to visit the campus. Nevertheless, we have all the faculty members here, and Dr. Ganesh can give talk to faculty members in face-to-face mode, and for students, he'll be giving the same topic in online mode. I don't want to take your time, and let us listen from our chief guest. A warm welcome, sir. I welcome Dr. Devasena for organizing this meeting. I welcome Dr. Manimegalai. I welcome heads of departments, Dr. Ali, Vittuvel. I welcome Dr. Gangadharan. I welcome Professor Perumal, Dr. Malar, all senior faculty members and faculty members who are present here. Let us listen from the chief guest. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I feel privileged to introduce Dr. Professor L.S. Ganesh. He has done B.E. Honors Mechanical Engineering in Vixpilani 1977. That, well, I think that shows us the connection between our principal and Dr. L.S. Ganesh. And he has done M.Tech Maintenance Management in IIT Madras in 1979. Probably most of us might not have born at that time. He has done Ph.D. in Forecasting System Dynamics Educational Planning in 1986 at IIT Madras. Then after that, it is always upward movement in his career. He has been professor in the Department of Management Studies, IIT Madras, during 1994 and till he retired from IIT Madras. He was the associate fellow in the Educational Planning Unit at the National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, New Delhi, for more than 2 terms. He is the key member of many national level projects sponsored by ISRO and MHRD. And also the international projects concerned integrated coastal zone management sponsored by the World Bank and UNDP. He has served as the secretary and vice president of the Society of Operations Management and as the vice president of the Product Development Management Association. He has been the advisor for various sales and forums and committees in IIT Madras, to name a few: Academic Advisory Council for the Project Management Institute and Advisory Board of the Chennai Fund, which is the TAI, the Indus Entrepreneurs. I am sure all of us know what is TAI. And he was the coordinator for the strategic planning exercise in IIT Madras. He has served as advisor, the cultural part of it, advisor of the Gymkhana, as professor in charge for human resources development in the institute. And also, more importantly, that is the relevant for us today, he was also the advisor for the cell for professional ethics and human values. Dr. Ganesh is also an accomplished rock, blues and jazz vocalist and rhythm guitarist. He strongly believes that India and Indians have exceptional capabilities that require well-directed and intensely focused organizational efforts to enable them and result in inspiring and peerless and timeless achievements. Sir, our principal Dr. Mohan Ram has planned for this lecture several months ago, and he has been talking about it in the HOD meetings as well. We are very eager to pay our special attention to your lecture, sir. The dais is yours.
Manakam, and good morning to all the colleagues. Very happy to meet some old friends again after a long time. And I was informed that this is the first talk after the lockdowns are slowly being relaxed. So I'm very happy to have this opportunity. And let me also greet my young friends who are online, who are listening to this talk. I don't know where you are, but my heart will be with you. Okay, I'll put it that way. Hope someday, God willing, we will all meet. Okay. I don't know whether there is God. If there is one, we will meet. I'm not against the concept of God. Let me put that also. Okay, I'm not agnostic. I would believe that there is one. I'll start with that. So, given the time that we have, I'll try to. I use the board because I'm still a traditional, old school teacher. In fact, I even between the whiteboard and the green or blackboard, I prefer the green or blackboard for several reasons. Okay. But nevertheless, it's all right. We'll make the best use. It was in Coimbatore some years ago. One of my friends in a meeting organized by CII had mentioned, he was talking to the audience. Of course, later during lunch, we were just having a brief conversation. But what he said in the audience was very, very interesting and humorous. He said, people use PowerPoint when they have neither power nor point. You know? So, of course, that was in a humorous sense. I'm sure I've also used PowerPoint. It's not that I've not used, but I minimize the use of PowerPoint because it's very important to have the attention of the audience to the maximum extent possible. I'm stating this because, you know, we have all been members of audience, and we know the number of times thoughts come in our mind. We are physically present in the audience, but mentally we are somewhere else. Not because we are deliberately doing it. It's just the flow of thoughts that happen, which we are not able to rein in sometimes. That's okay. That's life, and we carry on. You know, you can even ask the question, is it ethical to be in an audience physically and mentally somewhere else? Well, I don't know the answer. The answer has to be given by each person to himself or herself, you know. But there is a principle that's behind the answer, which is very, very important, which I learned from my wife, who learned it from some speaker in a talk somewhere else. Okay? So we have to, in academia, we always quote who said what and when and so on. Sir, in fact, Chandramohan and other friends, very often I've shared this, you know, for heaven's sake, avoid technology whenever you can. It's very, very important. Okay? Technology is critical. I mean, I'm not raising a debate on that. But when you can avoid technology, it's better to avoid it. Okay? Don't overuse. That's very important. I must also welcome my very dear friend, Professor Ramchandran. He's from Saraswati Thyagaraja College of Pollachi. A very, very dear friend. And actually, I have a meeting after this, so both of us will travel together. So I requested the permission to have him attend the talk. So thank you very much. I was telling you about the principle behind a very interesting principle about our thoughts, you know. So what my wife had shared about what she had learned. Apparently that wise person, whoever it was, who had talked, had mentioned that human beings do not have the capability to directly and deliberately control the rise of thoughts in their minds. None of us can do that. What she said was, it's true. It's almost impossible, perhaps impossible, for us to deliberately control the rise of a thought. How can you predict what thought is going to happen in your mind next, even the next very moment or nano moment or whatever you may want? We cannot. Okay? But do you agree that you have the authority and the right and perhaps the perspective and also the behavioral controls with you to continue with a thought or not? Is that within your scope or not? That's well within our scope. Once a thought comes and we observe, all of us are intelligent. I'm talking of normal human beings, legally normal human beings. Very, very important, you know, because somebody can be declared legally abnormal. So I'm talking of legally normal human beings. We can observe our thoughts. So whether you want to continue with a thought or not is in your control. You cannot control the rise, but you can control the continuation of the thought. So the story of ethics begins there also. Okay. So whether you want to continue with a thought or not, and what are you doing? Okay? This is one point. Now, where does the actual story of ethics start? I'm not going to take you into spiritualism or religion, etc., because I'll make it as neutral as possible. That's very, very important when we discuss ethics. But it all starts with a particular belief. Okay, it's a belief. There are some underlying principles for that belief. Okay, I'll use the board now.
So we have the belief that at the pinnacle of all our existence, known conscious existence, we have something called the universal eternal truth. We make that a conceptual entity. We have something called a universal eternal truth, where the understanding is that it is universal. That means any piece of consciousness, incidentally, I hope all of you agree by definition, all of us here, or each one of us, is a piece of consciousness. You have your consciousness, I have my consciousness, and everybody has their consciousness. We can perceive each other through our senses. Okay. Now, whether that is the universal eternal truth, we don't know. The correct state is we don't know. For example, right now, is anyone here experiencing complete universal oneness in this auditorium? Experiencing. I'm not talking of this thing. I hope you got. There's a difference between understanding and experiencing. You know, I can tell you I had very good breakfast today. At best, you can appreciate and understand, and your own mental model of what is a good breakfast would hit you. But can you go through the experience that I had? You cannot. This is a very, very important point. And there are many anecdotes in our mythology on this. It's a very interesting point, starting from ethics also. Please note this, my dear student friends also. There's a difference between what you understand and what you experience. And they're not the same. There may be, if you draw Venn diagrams, there may be a huge intersection area. That's all I can say. But you can't say it'll be completely coincidental. Not only that, there's another fact which is very, very important in our lives, that of tacit knowledge. Knowledge itself is explicit or tacit. And tacit knowledge means knowledge that you have, that you recognize that you know, but you cannot express. You cannot express it. I can give you examples of this. This especially to my young student friends who are listening. Just go ask your mothers how she makes that wonderful vatta kolambu poondrasam. Just ask her and ask her to explain. At best, she can give you the recipe. And for heaven's sake, you try the recipe and get the same damn taste. I'll challenge you. You cannot. And in Tamil, they say kai padam. You know. So you have that. Or in Hindi, they say hath ka jadu. You know. It's the magic of your hand. You know? You go ask the great Sachin Tendulkar, sir, how do you execute that exquisite cover drive of yours? At best, you can take a bat and say, aise. You try it, you're going to get the same results. No. So you can understand what he's saying. You can understand what your mother is going to say. Or you can understand your friend in some context. But you cannot go through their experiences. This is the... Now there's this anecdote. This was the challenge which changed Ratnakar into Valmiki. If you go through the mythology of the Ramayana, it's very interesting. So apparently, I'm cutting a long story short. Narada meets Ratnakar is a bandit. He's a waylayer. He's a robber, actually. Okay. So he meets and there is a conversation. And in the conversation, cutting a long conversation short, Narada challenges him. You please check whether your wife will accept your karma. So Valmiki says, what the hell? It's her duty. She's my wife. She has to accept my karma. So Ratnakar goes home and then there is a conversation. Then he asks his wife, will you accept my karma? She says, look, I am your wife. I'll accept all your nonsense, but I cannot accept your karma because you are you, I am me. I cannot accept you. Even if I want to, I cannot accept your karma. And that was his moment of truth. And Ratnakar changes into Valmiki. I'll put it that way. So experiencing is something very critical in the journey of our understanding of ethics. Okay? Because ultimately, you know your truths that you cannot deny. And that's the second step. Worldly truths. Worldly truths are our truths which we either experience directly or we understand, learn and understand. Those are our truths. Okay? I'll give a simple example. A belief in Tamil Nadu is people in Coimbatore region are very well behaved, they're very cultured, etc. It's a strong belief. Okay. Now, a person who's never visited Coimbatore can have faith in that statement because let's say I've never visited Coimbatore. Chandramohan is a dear friend, and Chandramohan tells me in Tamil, Ganesh Coimbatore ella nalla manchanga mariyadaya pesuvanga. I will trust Chandramohan. I'll have faith in him because he's my friend. Okay, so I will trust him and I'll form a mental model of Coimbatore. Now that mental model will constantly be challenged during my experiences in Coimbatore. I hope you got it. Now, if the experiences are conforming to what Chandramohan had described to me, then my mental model gets consolidated and strengthened. And I say, yeah, I also share that belief. And maybe even one or two unpleasant experiences may not dominate my pleasant experiences. And I say, look, in general, Coimbatore is a wonderful place. You know? So we hold a belief. And let's all understand beliefs are a part of our ethical system. Incidentally, I'll introduce another word called morals. We'll talk about the morals and ethics and the subtle differences some thinkers have brought out. Okay? So our worldly truths. Ungaludaya ulaga reethiyana anubhavangalum unmaigalum nambikaigalum. Our beliefs, our understanding, our knowledge, our experiences, all of them come here. Worldly truths ku vandu naal context irukku. There are four contexts. Ethics inga dhaan varudhu. Enna indha process irukku paarenga. This is a belief across all religions, by the way. There is no difference. All religions is a belief. Any religion you take, the individual person, I'm talking of the human context. I'm not talking of animals like lions and cheetahs and snakes or insects like cockroaches, etc. I'm talking of our context as human beings, our species, okay, our understanding of the world, nature, time, consciousness, etc., okay, which are big topics. Ingiye, this journey involves the effort to attain perfection, because our mental model by definition is this is perfect. This is our definition. The universal, eternal truth is perfect. Now one can philosophically challenge, is there actually a universal eternal truth? Is there one? But I already started. The perfect answer according to me is, I don't know. And I can qualify it saying, I hope there is one. Maybe I believe there is one. Correct answer is, I don't know. I don't know neither by understanding nor by experience. I'll put it that way. Okay, but I can get into what is called as a surrogate understanding. Okay, because definitely I can start with this logic that in my consciousness, nothingness does not exist. I hope you got it. Because I'm sure I'm perceiving something, so nothingness is out of logic. There is a somethingness, and that somethingness, there is infinite variety around me. This is an observable fact. There is infinite variety around me in that somethingness. So I would argue, tend to argue, that there must be some least common, you know, factor through all that exists, which pervades everything. There should be something which is the universal eternal truth. Should it be physical? I don't know. Maybe part of it is physical. But this is a wonderful challenge, because even the hardest nut among atheists has to answer one question. He or she has to perceive nature around him or her. Assuming it's a normal human being physically with all the senses, sight, smell, taste, touch, hearing, etc., can that atheist deny the existence of nature within and without? If that person denies, I don't have a quarrel, I'll say, you have your life, I have my life. I'm not going to argue any further with that person. There's no point. Because in my mind, I'm dealing with an entity that's deceiving itself, which is unethical, by the way. I'm already feeding forward something for you. when you delude yourself, when you deceive yourself, please note, you are violating personal ethics. And I'm sure there are many moments in our lives where each one of us, simple people, have deceived ourselves. Touch your heart and answer this question. You cannot deny it. Okay? But it happens. We are normal human beings. So there's nothing wrong. You don't need to feel, you don't need to break your head over that. Okay? It happens in your journey. So this journey is a journey of learning. This journey is a journey of learning where we transcend worldly truths to go to the universal eternal truths in our own consciousness, which you and only you can experience, as I already shared. Nobody else can go through that experience. It is you and only you. But in many traditions and societies, cultures, historically, there have been equivalent of gurus in those societies, wherever on earth. I mean, it may be India, it may be China, it may be America, the Red Indians, it may be anywhere. There have been those equivalents of that master or the teacher who guides others. Okay. For example, in India, even as recent as the last century, until 1950, one such guru who is celebrated by many people was Ramana Maharishi. He died in 1950 in Thiruvannamalai. So people say, yes, he was a guru. And in fact, there are lovely writings about him. By the way, I am not his devotee. Please let me tell you that. Very often we do engage in talks or thoughts about others and share them. But doesn't mean we are completely aligned. It doesn't mean. I'm talking of something that is useful. I'll put it that way. Okay. It doesn't mean I'm not a devotee also. Don't put me on the other side. No? So I'm just very neutral on that. Maybe I admire that spirit very much, okay, for whatever little I've learned. But people have said in writing, we go with many questions before him. We don't know the answers. We go sit before him. He doesn't talk. We come out with answers. Now, how do you explain this? People have written about it, and not one or two. So many people have written about it. Munnadi poi okkaran sir answer laam varudhu pesa maatran mancham pesa maatengran ana answer enakku varudhu. But this is true of communication. Do you agree? Normal communication, does this happen or not? I'm just taking you a little bit. A lot of interpersonal communication depends on three things. Number one, body language, which people say contributes to 60 to 65% of the effectiveness of your communication. Remember, body language is non-verbal. There are no words. Then diction, that is how you express those words. And then that's about some 20-25%. And after that is words. Okay. It's like, I'll take this. Shankar, I met him today. I don't think we met each other earlier, Shankar, have we? Okay, Shankar is a, let me say. By the way, please accept me as a friend. Okay, that's something I should have requested you earlier on. I've come here as a friend. Okay. Don't put me on the pedestal of a professor and destroy me. Okay, please do not do that. I'm a simple human being. I'm a friend. I've come here. Let's say Shankar is there. And I'm going to tell you about this communication, what it means. Because there is ethics in this also. That's why I'm stating this. Shankar, I think you're a good man. What were my words? Shankar, I think you are a good man. You noted the way I told you, Shankar. Shankar, I think you're a good man. You watched the change in my body language. First time, what was I doing? I was looking at him and telling him, Shankar, I think you're a good man. Watch my eyes, watch my body language. Second time, Shankar, I think you're a good man. Are you getting the same message? I use the same words? Correct? Third, okay. Shankar, I think you're a good man. Did you get the same message? Even he might wonder, what the hell is this guy doing? So, please understand, there are subtle variations. I'm using the same words, but I'm sending a different signal to him. Okay, so these are part and parcel of our transactions. Please understand. I told you all this only to support the observation that your truths are yours and yours only. They can be somebody else's by understanding or by faith or by appreciation. They cannot be somebody else's by experience. It's impossible. It's a very, very, very important point. Now, couple it to another very important point. None of us is the sole repository of all truth. This is a very important starting point in administrative ethics, even institutional administrative ethics. None of us is the sole repository of all truth in an institutional administrative setting, if you want to bring that setting. Naam poduvave solren, none of us is the sole repository of any truth or all truth. We're not. So there is a humility that we have to bring in straight away in our discourse, in our lives. I hope our student friends are listening. Can any one of you claim that you are the sole repository of all truth in any matter? Come on. Whom are you fooling? We cannot state that. That is why in civilization, we have this whole concept of discourse, discussion, argumentation, debate, etc., inquiry, etc. That is why you have that. Because together, maybe we will collectively move a little bit from here to here together in that long journey. In that long journey where we know, we only hope that there will be a time when we will experience that oneness. Have there been people who have been observed to have demonstrated or given signals of that oneness? Yes. Very many people talk of such great people in human form, great spirits in human form, who have given indications of that kind of oneness. You know, but you're not experienced. It's only that you admire. Okay, very great. It looks like that person has got into that state of oneness. Okay, that's all you can say. Because I'm a simple human being and I have faith. Okay, that's all we can say. Okay, fine. So there's a learning process. This is a spiritual learning process. But there's another learning process which is looping in here. It's an endogenous self loop whereby our worldly experience, we keep learning new truths and modifying or consolidating our existing truths. By daily experiences, you go through this. I'm sure many of you have children. Can you confidently say your mental model of your child was constant? You cannot. Those of you who are married, can you say your mental model of your spouse has remained constant? You cannot. Can you say there has been a stable part of that mental model? Probably yes. If you ask me to describe my wife, I can definitely describe her on certain stable characteristics that she has displayed. And I'll say, my wife is characterized by A, B, C, D, E, etc. I can do that. And I'm sure she will do that for me. So that may be a stable part. But is that stable part enough for me to predict my wife's behavior, say, if she's here, in the next 10 minutes? Or can she predict my behavior in the next 10 minutes? No. But there's a familiarity that we build which we are confident about. That's all we can say. So this self loop is important. Because this is how we learn through our experiences. That is why there is always that saying, you know, people who don't learn are fools. Because you are not articulating your worldly truths. Then comes another question. But should you articulate all worldly truths to everybody? Well, I don't have an answer. Wisdom says don't do it. You know, wisdom says don't do it. So this is where we are. I told you there are four contexts of our worldly truth. This is where the setting for ethics comes. One, personal. Sorry. This is personal alone. This is interpersonal, IP, at work. Third is interpersonal at home. And fourth is, it's neither personal or interpersonal, it's a question mark in public. These are the four contexts for any human being where ethics works. Ethics is relevant in these four contexts. Me alone, naan tanimayil, me at work, naan en velai soolnilaiyil, professional setting, me at home, naan en kudumba soolnilaiyil, and me in public, naan podu vaazhvil, adhu podu soolnilai. இந்த நாலு சூழ்நிலைகள் தான் இருக்கு மனுஷனுக்கு, எந்த மனுஷனுக்குமே. எனிபாடி நவ் வேர் ஆர் வி? மீ அலோன், தட் மீன்ஸ் ஐ ஆம் அலோன், ஐ எம் நாட் வித் எனிபடி எல்ஸ், ஐ எம் நாட் ரிலேட்டிங் டு எனிபடி எல்ஸ், ஐ ஆம் இன் திஸ் லூப், ஐ எம் இன் தட் லூப். நான் என்னுள் எண்டோஜினஸ்லி சம் தாட் ப்ராசஸ் ஆர் ஹேப்பனிங், மை இமேஜினேஷன், மை லாஜிக், மை அனலிட்டிக்கல் பவர்ஸ், மை சைலன்ஸ், all of them are happening in some form or the other. I am living with myself, my beliefs, my confidence, my confusion, you know, my fears, everything are in me. I'm not relating to anybody. That's me alone. But remember, I'm going through this loop because obviously we expect that we are observing ourselves, and hopefully this reflection process is going to take us small steps in that journey, hopefully small steps, because we believe the better a person understands himself or herself, the better the quality of this journey. Okay, then me at work, naan velai sunil, I am there with my colleagues, with my superiors, with my subordinates, with my peer group, perhaps with my partners, with my regulators, whatever. They're all there. That's my work situation. I'm interacting with them in an official context. Okay? So technically speaking, our talk today is me at work. For me, I hope you agree. In my reference frame, I am at work. Okay, by designation, I'm a professor retired. I'm doing my work now. I'm sharing my knowledge with you. And you're doing your work. You're going to interact with me and share your experiences. So we look together, we move ahead. So that's my work. Me at home. I was at home day before yesterday. I am with my family, with my spouse, my children, my grandchildren, my sisters, my brother-in-law, my uncles, aunts, grandparents, whosoever. Main neighbors. Kudumba soolnilai. I'm stating this because any violation of ethics happens in these four contexts. I hope you got it. Violation of ethics happens when you're alone. I'll explain through examples. Violation of ethics happens at work. Violation of ethics happens at home. And I'll come out with a simple model. Me in public. Like I'm in Chennai airport yesterday. Am I at home? No. Am I at work? No. Am I alone? Maybe. But I'm definitely in public. You know why I said, am I alone? Please note, this is a very special status. I'll put a star. Literally speaking, you can be alone in the other three contexts. Yes or no? This has happened. Very often, I'm just sitting and I'm having, say, lunch or dinner with my wife. And that itself is a joy very often. Okay. And she's talking to me. I'm looking at her. And after about 6 minutes, she's asking me, what do you say? And I ask her, Lakshmi, nee enna sonna? That means I'm doing everything honest physically. Because I'm looking at her. She thinks I'm listening. But what is my state of consciousness? Yengyo poit. Even I'm not in control. It's gone somewhere. So she then innocently, she asked me, "Nee enna pa solra? What shall we do na? Nee enna sonna?" Adina, obviously, I have been alone. I hope you got it. I've been with her physically, but I'm alone. Fact is verified that I was alone. Why? Because, please understand, when a person is unmindful of the situation and is immersed, that is loneliness. Now, wife order, I'm not mindful of the fact that I'm having lunch or dinner with her. I'm not mindful. And I've slipped off into something. So I'm alone. So this is... Now, did I violate ethics? The answer is yes. I did violate ethics. And I'll explain why also. Okay? But idu vandu jailukku pora kutram kedaiyadhu. Okay? It is something which is a normal social violation that all of us are subject to. I mean, we are sometimes... we are innocent, I'll put it that way. Can I control the rise of a thought? I cannot. Engayo poi maatintanla adu oru soral mari enna iluthurthu ulla, and I'm not even realizing that I'm stuck in it. I realize only after she has enna pa solra enna pannala, then the switch goes on. Oho, ive edho solli iruka. You know, 5-6 minutes she's been talking to me something and I didn't register. Okay, so that's what happens. Do you agree? Same thing can happen at work also. I'm very confident you and I have been both perpetrators as well as victims of the same phenomenon. Is this true or not? There are many times when I go to somebody, you know, I must have been a young assistant professor, HOD edho sollindirukkaru, na avara paathinde aha, and that man must be thinking, aha, what a wonderful colleague, ivlo concentrated a kekkarar ennu. He would have, luckily many times I escape without further questions. Luckily. Okay. Sometimes if the HOD is a normal, I mean, he just asks, Ganesh, what do you say? Nah, I can't, if it's my wife, I can say, enna sonnane? HOD, can I say that? Nah, the straight multiple is, sir, I would like to have some time before I answer you. Avar nanchuvar, aha, what a thoughtful person. Neja namakku thana theriyum. Isn't it? Now this, all of us engage in. I'm sure even our student friends did the same thing in their cricket teams or basketball teams or volleyball teams or in their own gupshup in cafeterias. Don't tell me you are concentrating all the time. Don't give me this bullshit. I'm not going to buy you. Okay. We all do that. We are simple human beings. Okay. So these four contexts are where this happens. Now comes the three ethical contexts which we have to look at. Now these are the direct personal contexts. There are three ethical contexts. Okay. First is, I'm talking of worldly truths, okay? That's why I put it here. I'm talking of worldly truths. So you can even bring it down further into personal truths. And there is a journey from personal truths to worldly truths. And the wise people make that journey strongly. Remember, the more distance the individual is from worldly truths, the greater the risk of perception mismatches of that person. I hope you got it. Risk is higher. Nadakkum aanithrama solla mudiyadhu. You can't affirm that something bad will happen, but the risk is definitely much higher if you're far away from worldly truths. Okay? It will trouble you. There are some worldly... By the way, when I say truth... Worldly truth, do not imagine any particular attribution of value of good, bad, evil, etc. to the worldly truth. Please do not do that wrong attribution. Because some worldly truths are truths, but undesirable. Example, corruption in government offices. It is a worldly truth. But is it desirable? No. Unmaya illaya corruption in government offices? Why should I say government offices? Corruption sometimes in our educational institutions. I have a very close friend who did his PhD in some well-known university without naming anybody. And that fellow used to tell me, sir, if I go stand in front of my guide's office, I have to pay 5,000. If I knock, another 5,000. If he says, open the door, 10,000. If he looks up, another 5,000. If he says, come in, 10,000. If he says, sit down, another 10,000. PhD guide and PhD student. And I will trust my friend. There is no reason why that fellow should lie. By the way, I'm on TV. Or rather, I'm recorded. I'm telling you this truth because this is the message that my friend shared with me. And I have no reason to disbelieve him. Let me put it that way. And is it possible that what he said is true? It seems possible because other friends have confirmed that they went through the same experiences in the same university. Maybe with different guide. Okay, Could this be false? Yes, it could be false. The whole thing could be false. I'm only a normally intelligent human being, normal intelligence, and I would only say probabilities. What is the probability that it is true? I'll say, given my friend's words and others' words, it looks like I'll give a probability of 80% that it's true. What is the probability that it is false? I'll say the probability that it is false is probably only 10%. We talk with probabilities. Please understand, we never talk with certainty. When you're really, you're perceiving well, you will talk of probabilities and risk. You will never talk about certainties. Because real world is full of probability. Okay? In fact, nothing can be certain. Many people say uncertainty is the only certainty. You know, there is a joke about it. So we live in a world where our perspectives are different, our understanding is different, our observations are different. Right now, I'll ask you, all of you will confirm, are you receiving my signals the same way? Can anybody guarantee that here? It's not possible, please. So let's understand the simple truth. Our truths are our truths. But can we build intersections of truths through our interactions? Of course, yes. We can converse and see how much we have commonly understood or commonly share, etc. That we can discover. Okay. So the first context is the ethical thing. Personal ethics. I'll put it as PE. Personal ethics. So you can look at a matrix actually. Ethics to you as a person. I've not yet defined ethics, but I'm just giving you the grounds. It's like if I want to describe cricket, I'm going to tell you what is the ground, what is the pitch, what's the field, where the boundary. I'm giving you that kind of a mental model now. Okay. Second is interpersonal ethics. Interpersonal ethics. Ethics in our relationships with each other. By the way, these are the settings in which ethics can be upheld or violated. Can be conformed with or non-compliance. And the third one is called systemic ethics. Systemic ethics. That of a system. It may be the traffic system in Coimbatore. It may be the healthcare system. It may be the education system. Isn't it? It may be the public administration system. But we are all engaging in relationships in all those ethical contexts. Systemic ethics. We are part of a system. And nobody can deny that. For example, at a very large, in a very large perspective, we are all an integral part of the Indian political system. We are a legally valid part of the Indian political system. The Indian legal system, the Indian socio-cultural system, the Indian economic system, and so on. Can we violate ethics? Of course, you can. For example, if I hold black money, I'm violating systemic ethics in addition to personal ethics. Please note this. I'm automatically violating systemic ethics. Why? Because the system says you cannot hold black money. And you and I are a part of that system. Kalla vote podrathu is a violation of systemic ethics. I hope you got it. Corrupted votes are a violation of systemic ethics. System says you can't do that. I hope you got it. Knowingly issuing a wrong check to somebody is a violation of interpersonal ethics. I hope you got it. I know that I'm giving a wrong check to the guy. That guy doesn't know. That guy will find out only when the bank transactions happen. And by that time, I'm not there. It's a violation of interpersonal ethics. To some extent, violation of systemic ethics also. Because I'm also taking the bank for a ride a little bit. Please understand why I said this. These are not watertight compartments. Please note, there is an intersection between them, but largely you classify them as personal ethics, interpersonal ethics, and systemic ethics. I hope this is clear. Okay? Now you can construct the matrix. Easy. So you have a framework on which you can judge ethics. I can have personal alone violation of personal ethics. personal alone violation of interpersonal ethics. You might wonder how. Personal alone systemic ethics. When I am alone, I am not relating to anybody. I am scheming for some destruction of a systemic part. I am violating systemic ethics when I am alone. I hope you got it. Sadhi pannindirukken naan. I am alone. I hope you got it. If I am doing some treachery to the institution I work for when I am alone, but my thoughts are getting into treachery towards that institution, I'm clearly violating systemic ethics in a personal context. And I'm also violating my personal ethics. Why? Because I'm continuing with that thought of destroying a system. I hope you got it. Purinjitha, rise of the thought you cannot control, but continuation you can control. And suppose a person gets vicarious happiness by thinking of the destruction of the system, whether it's an institution or something else, it is sad. Then you're not talking of a human being, you're talking of a sadist. I hope you got it. That person during that time is a sadist. He or she is not a normal human being anymore. I hope the frame is useful to you now. Okay. I have to keep looking at the watch. Up to what time can we go, sir? You can tell me, please. Yeah, I'll try my best to see to it. But but I hope I'm on the right track. Okay. No, not at all. In fact, you can feel free to, anybody can feel free as a friend to intervene and ask. Okay. 11 is okay, no? Please. Okay, I'll try my best. Now, what is the reference frame for all this? The reference frame comes from a very important word called purpose. So when I want to judge whether something is ethical or not ethical, I have to judge against a scale. That reference scale is purpose. So in every context that you can think of, use your intelligence, use your good senses, and talk of what's the purpose. Okay, now let me give an example to students. Okay, I'm not sure, can they answer any one of them? Is that possible? Then all of them know Tamil also, or is there, could there be people who don't know Tamil? Mostly Tamil theriyum ellarkum. Since there may be some of you who would not know Tamil, I'll continue, but I'll use Tamil, but I'll translate for the benefit of those who do not know Tamil. Okay? Fine. I'm asking you a question. Today, I would like at least one student to answer, please. Today, if you print a visiting card for yourself, what will your visiting card say? Please answer this question. Anybody, any student who's listening to this lecture, if you will print your visiting card today, what will your visiting card say? What will be the contents of your visiting card? To help you, I will use Chandramohan. Chandramohan, you have a visiting card now? Irka? Kudunga. No, because I'll give them an example. Yeah, sure. You have to unmute and talk, guys and girls. Yeah, we'll do that. We'll definitely do that. Chandramohan's visiting card is very straight. It says, I'll try to avoid using my specs. Dr. G. Chandramohan, Vice Principal, PSG Institute of Technology and Applied Research, Neelambur, Coimbatore. Then he has his phone numbers, email, website, etc. That's the content of his visiting card. That's in my hands. There's something behind also, but not relevant now. Okay, I'll put it that way. This is Dr. Chandramohan's visiting card. And I've told you what it contains. He's put his name, his designation, okay. I would suggest something to Chandramohan as a good friend. Aduthavati endha faculty num potrungo. Although you're vice principal, your academic roots also have to be established. Okay. Vice principal is an institutional designation, but where do I stand in the academy? Mechanical, yeah. So I would like at least one student to answer this question. If you were to print your visiting card, What will you state on your visiting card? Come on, guys. Unmute. Yeah, good morning. Who is this?
Sir, I am Ratin from CSE department, sir.
Ratin?
Yes, sir.
Oh, very nice. Thank you. God bless you, Ratin. Because I'll tell you why. Many of my friends know. After a very long, long time, I'm hearing a male student answering first. It's always a lady who has answered first. Okay. Yeah, sorry. Okay, Ratin, go ahead. Yeah.
So my visiting card will be containing my name.
Yeah, cholunga, what's your name, Ratin? Full.
I'm Ratin Ashwath, sir.
Ratin Ashwath, name. Then what's the next line?
Current course is, sir.
Illa. What is your program of study?
I'm doing BE Computer Science and Engineering.
BE Computer Science and Engineering, first year.
Yes.
Correct? Sir. Yeah, go ahead.
Or a line about my degree.
You don't need to, in a visiting card, normally we don't elaborate. Yeah, we just say basic. So you say Ratin Ashwath, BE Computer Science and Engineering, first year program, PSG Institute of Technology and Applied Research, Nilambur. Correct, Ratin? Correct? Fine. Very correct, Ratin. Now, Ratin, what's your age? Okay, legally you're an adult?
Yes, sir.
Correct, huh?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. By the way, by religious traditions in India, your karma clock starts after your 11th birthday, by the way. Okay. Until you're 11 years old, you are exempt from certain things. 11 years, kapra clock ticks, tuck, tuck, tuck. Okay. And our mental model, Chitragupthan, kanak ezhuda aarambichara, ungalku or ledger la or page irukum ungalku. Okay. Anyway, we'll come to that. Ratin, thank you. Ratin, do you agree that designation of being a student you have given to yourself?
Yes, sir. It is non-self-entity.
Absolutely. Will you agree if I say, no, Ratin, you should not be a student. You became a computer science student because your father and mother or uncle or aunt or neighbor forced you. Will you agree?
It may be true or false, sir.
Ippa nee edutha decision sollupa. You have taken a decision. Are you going to sit and fall back on your mother and father, or are you going to stand on your feet?
On my feet.
Avladan. That is it. Now, Ratin, since you have given yourself the designation of being a student in the BE Computer Science and Engineering program first year, by the way, my dear student friends, Ratin is an example or an instance. We are talking of all of you. This is the same story. Ratin, what are the duties of a student?
Learn well.
I'm very happy that you said that. Look, getting good marks is another matter, Ratin. I appreciate that. But adavadhu in learning with integrity, do you agree with that value system?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Adhukku dhaan nee student ah iruka. By the way, all of us professors by designation are eternal students. Don't forget that. You guys, after you finish BSc and join a job, to that extent, your studentship officially stops. Of course, you're a student of life, but you're not a student in an institution. But all my friends here assembled here, we're all students for life by our work itself. So we have a designation. Now I'm the professor in a boat. If I do everything but being a professor, am I violating ethics or not?
Yes, sir.
That's exactly the point. You know why I asked you, Ratin? Because I was a young student many, many years ago. And I'm confessing to you, in my first 3 years of the program, when I studied in BITS Pilani, I'm confessing, I was anything but a good student. Class a cut adipen, pakkathla desert ku poven, cinema paapen, and the 5 years of engineering la or 500 600 hindi padam paathirpen naan. Okay. But 3 years, I was a terrible student. I'm telling you that. Terrible to the core. But edho epdi epdi last minute la padichi epdi epdi edho pan vandach. Your tendency was that. That means I was not in control of myself. It's a very important question in ethics for all students. Every moment ask yourself this question. Am I controlling myself or is something else controlling me? Please ask this question. And I am very confident of one answer. And I hope I am wrong, But statistically, I may not be wrong. Very often I find young people are not in control of themselves. Their mobile phones control them. Okay? They are victims of their own mobile phones. Often. I'm not saying everybody, but it's noticeable. Now the point is this. I'm very grateful to you, Ratin, for that answer. The prime duty of a student is to learn. But does it mean you learn all the 24 hours? Ratin?
Balance.
Ah, beautiful. You use the correct word. 24 manaram padichanalum you are unethical. Please understand that. We say, sir, my prime duty is to learn and I learn all 24 hours. Now you are being unethical. You know why? You are violating personal alone ethics. That means you are not having proper diet. You are not having proper control over your body. You are not having proper rest. You are not giving yourself rejuvenation. You are not maximizing the quality of your learning. You will soon end up as a mad guy if you're learning all the time. Isn't it? We're not talking of that. I'm very happy, Ratin, you used the word balanced. Where does that come? Purpose. So what's my prime purpose as a student? To learn. So ask yourself that question. Am I learning? Am I in control of my learning? That's a very fair question. I hope you got it, Ratin. Okay? So purpose. Is there a common purpose to all of us? Yes. There is a common purpose to all, within quotes, legally normal human beings. I'm again and saying legally, because the law can place a person as abnormal, isn't it, under certain circumstances. Solla maten. Happiness is a state of mind, illaya. It depends on that. And actually, between you and me, if you ask me to choose between deep inner peace and happiness, I'll choose the former. I want deep inner peace. Okay. So, I'm not saying happiness is wrong. Andamari solla. Preference na solla. Okay. So, that's the thing. Okay. Anyway, you got it. Is there a common substrate for us as a reference frame that defines purpose for all of us? Answer is yes. What is that common substrate? Okay. I'm not going to go into a big, winded discussion. I have to cut a long story short. I'll just say you have to answer the question, why do we do what we do? Simple, basic, fundamental question. Elementary. Why do you do what you do? Why am I here and I'm talking? Why are my friends sitting here and listening, hopefully? Isn't it? And it goes on. Why are you there watching online? Why are you doing what you're doing? If you dive deep into that question, you will discover that there are certain common or minimum representative factors for all our lives. The first aim of human life, or the first fundamental reason why we do what we do, is survival. I hope you got it. So I'll write here, survival. Now, I hope my student friends agree, for all of us, this is the first basic aim. First, let me survive, then I'll talk about other things. Because beyond survival, none of us knows anything. None of us knows what's there beyond survival. If somebody knows, it'll be personal knowledge. You cannot convince somebody else. It's very difficult. Unless that person has faith in you. It's like one of my very good friends taught me a wonderful question. It was a philosophical question. He asked me, Ganesh, assume for a moment that you have a very, very dear friend for whom you will even lay down your life. He's such a good friend. But that friend is born blind. Born blind. Can you please explain to your friend what the color green is? Have you got the challenge? How do you explain to such a dear friend of yours who's born blind what is green or red or blue? In a diffraction theory, will it make any sense? The guy doesn't know, yeah? You are experiencing green when you see green, or you are experiencing red when you're seeing red. How will you know that your friend is going through that? This is a very basic truth of life in, of course, green and red and blindness are only context. I talked of this example of a physical blindness. Do you, all of you agree that very often we are mentally blind and blocked to something? We are blind. Somebody else has to put the switch on the power. In fact, good teachers are supposed to do that with your students. வந்து தட்டி இதை பாரு இங்க சுவிட்ச் இருக்கு இந்த சுவிட்ச் ஆன் பண்ணுன்னு சொல்லணும் டீச்சர். அண்ட் த ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ் டு டிஸ்கவர் ஓஹோ என்னுள்ளே இந்த சுவிட்ச் இருந்திருக்கா. யூனோ தட் அ ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ் இஸ் சப்போஸ் டு டிஸ்கவர் ஓ மை காட் ஐ ஹேட் தட் டேம் சுவிட்ச் இன் மீ அண்ட் ஐ டென்ட் நோ அண்ட் தேங்க்ஸ் டு த டீச்சர் ஹூ ரிவீல் தட் சுவிட்ச் இன்சைட் மீ அண்ட் மேட் மீ லேர்ன். ஸோ ஐ ஹோப் யூ காட் தட்ஸ் வை வி சே குரு இஸ் அ பர்சன் ஹூ கிவ்ஸ் லைட். தட் லைட் இஸ் நத்திங் பட் ஷோயிங் த ஸ்டூடெண்ட் த சுவிட்ச் இஸ் ஆல்ரெடி இன்சைட் ஹிம் ஆர் ஹர். And the fellow is ignorant, doesn't know that the switch is inside. And then you learn. You learn to learn. All these things happen. Okay? So, survival is the first basic aim. First, let us survive. Survival itself has two contexts. I hope all of you agree. Physical and mental. Do you agree? And what is on top? Basic aims. Basic aims of human life. First basic aim is survival. And physical, mental, namma renda pirikalam. Which is short term and long term. Short term and long term. Now, how do we... I hope all of you got it. Now I request any friend here to answer, what is it that you do to survive? What do we do to survive? Anybody can answer. Come on, we, adukku munnadi ondu iruke. Breathing first. Please notice, by the way, we perform some actions to fulfill our basic aims. Please do not forget this. Now, this is another starting point for upholding or violating ethics. Please note, it's another starting point. We breathe. Breathing is an action experience. I'll write it here. It's an action experience. We engage in an action experience, like breathing. Now, what consists of this action experience of breathing? What do you do when you breathe? Breathing is an action. So can we're all engineers. Can we break down that action into processes? Simple, dana, pandrad dana. Inhalation. Holding, exhalation, holding. In fact, nalla pranayam therinjavanga idu solluvanga. I start with emptiness, I inhale, I reach fullness, I hold, I exhale, reach emptiness, I hold, I inhale. Idu dhaan cycle of breathing, four stages. Emptiness, inhalation, fullness, exhalation, emptiness, inhalation. In the cycle dhaan breathing. Now comes the question, how many of us can say we breathe correctly? Huh? But are we breathing correctly? Correct means one answer is correct. But are we confident that we are breathing correctly? Absolutely. All of us know we are breathing. Thungumbodhu kuda deep sleep also, the action is taking place. But how many of us can confidently say we are breathing correctly? You know why I pose this question to all my student friends? Since I raised that question, I'm sure all of you will be very honest. We can definitely say we are breathing, but we cannot assert with the same confidence and self-belief that we are breathing correctly. We cannot. Okay. That means breathing lena correct len, there's a possibility of distortion of correct breathing. Do you agree? Our life should be more complex. Can anybody assert that he or she is living his or her life correctly? See, you're not even able to do it in your breathing, damn it. How the hell are you going to talk about your life which is far more complex. Okay, I'm just leaving you with that challenge and question. So please understand, the struggle to uphold ethics, morals, etc., itself is a noble struggle for which I'm building the framework. Inherently, it's a noble struggle. And another fundamental violation of ethics: if you stop to do that struggle, you're unethical. I hope you got it. The moment you stop to struggle with yourself to uphold ethics, morals, etc., and if you do that deliberately, that I'm not going to care anymore, you're automatically unethical. Okay? That means you're writing your own, scripting your own destiny in a certain way. Please understand, you're an author of your destiny in a large measure. You can't say no. Each one of us is an author of his or her destiny, you know. Is an author. Because your destiny is also written by others. It's not, you're not the lone, but you play a very important role. Okay, fine. Now comes here. What is breathing? Inhalation. What do you inhale and what do you exhale? We inhale air. Please note, very often people say oxygen. I think all of us should know, pure oxygen will kill you. I think doctor is there. Pure oxygen will kill you after some time. Air, which is a mixture, namak aaranglas aaranglas padipom, so much of nitrogen, so much of oxygen, so much of, correct na? So you're breathing air in a certain pattern and you experience the results of your breathing directly, you experience. Okay, fine. Now what is air? Don't give me this chemistry. What is air? Conceptually, what is air? Come on. By the way, my dear friends, I'm taking you through all this because, please, as a friend, I'm telling you, take your students through this journey. What is air? Okay, I'll help. Air is a public resource. Correct, huh? So we use resources. We use resources for what? To perform action experiences. And we do these under conditions. You want to give a live example of conditions? Was this object there last year, January? எங்கிருந்து வந்தது இது புது ரிசோர்ஸ்? ஏன் வந்தது புது ரிசோர்ஸ்? ஏன்னா நடுவில் எவனோ கொரோனான்னு கிளப்பி விட்டான். அவன் சொன்னா, யோ நீ மாஸ்க் போடலன்னா உனக்கு வந்து தொலைங்க. ஸோ யூ பெட்டர் வேர் த மாஸ்க் அப்படின்னு. ஸோ யூ ப்ராட் அனதர் ரிசோர்ஸ் ஃபார் வாட்? ஃபார் திஸ். ப்ளீஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட், டு மேக்சிமைஸ் யுவர் சர்வைவல் ப்ராபபிலிட்டி, to minimize your morbidity or mortality risk. So you are trying to be using a resource like this to protect yourself, to enhance your survival. So we use resources, action experiences and conditions to fulfill our basic aim of survival. I hope you got it. Air is a public resource. Air is a free public resource. Now, இங்கே தான் சிஸ்டமிக் எத்திக்ஸ் எல்லாம் வருது. I don't know whether bottled water இருக்கா? இல்லை இல்லை, இருக்கா? இருக்கா பாருங்க, ஜஸ்ட் இட்ஸ் ஃபார் அன் இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங் எக்ஸாம்பிள். இல்லை அது இல்லை, பிராண்டட் வாட்டர் பாட்டில் இருக்கா? இல்லைன்னா பரவாயில்ல. இல்லை இல்லை, டோன்ட் வரி, இல்லைன்னா விட்டுருங்க ப்ளீஸ். ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ ஹவ் சீன் கின்லே, ஆக்வாஃபினா, பிஸ்லரி, பெய்லி. இல்லை இல்லை, அவசரம் இல்லை. சந்திரமோகன் சார், ஐ டெல் யூ வை. Do all of you agree water is supposed to be a free public resource? Then engirundiya commoditize pannada? Now I'll ask Chandramohan, when you were a small boy, have you ever seen commoditized water? Tell me, sir. Today water, a free public resource, is commoditized. Please understand this truth. And I want to tell you, air has also been commoditized. Please understand this. பண்ணியாச்சு சார். சார் உங்களுக்கு தெரிஞ்சிருக்காது, சென்னை நல்லா தெரிஞ்சுனாக்கா, ஸ்பென்சர் மாலில் பல வருஷங்களுக்கு முன்னாடி தேர் வாஸ் அ பார் வேர் யூ பே சம் 10 ருபீஸ் ஆர் 20 ருபீஸ் அண்ட் பிரீத் குட் ஏர். Chennai la sir, forget about Los Angeles and Mexico City and Tokyo. அதுல என்ன என்ன தகராறுனா அந்த நல்ல காத்தை காமிச்சுட்டு நல்லா சுவாசிச்சுட்டு வெளில வந்து மவுண்ட் ரோடு காத்தான் திரும்பி சுவாசிக்கணும். அதே மவுண்ட் ரோடு ஏர் தான் வெளில வந்த. Are you understanding? So even air has been commoditized. Please understand this. I'm telling you because this sets up a different dimension of systemic ethics and socio-cultural ethics. Please understand, today, if you are a very poor person, your risk of not getting proper access to proper water is very high. That risk is very high. Now I want all of you students to understand, somewhere our country is also a signatory to the Sustainable Development Goals, where one of those goals is to make good water accessible to everybody. Why should air and water be the preserve of only the relatively more affluent people? That doesn't make any social sense. When a society does that as a whole, and there is a condition under which, independent of the government in power in Delhi, if we are in a condition where basic air and water are going to be less accessible by a certain section of the population, it is a violation of the ethics of life. And it is a national violation. It is not a personal violation. Please understand this. அதனால தான் பாரதியார் என்ன பாடினார், தனி ஒருவனுக்கு உணவில்லையே ஜகத்தினை அழித்திருவோம் அழித்திருவோம் பாடினார். ப்ளீஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட். ஓகே, ஹீஸ் அ ரொமான்டிக் போயட் இன் தட் சென்ஸ், பட் ப்ளீஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் த ஸ்பிரிட் வித் விச் தட் போயட் ரோட் இட். ஸோ ப்ளீஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட், எத்திக்ஸ் இஸ் நாட் ஒன்லி வயலேட்டட் பை அன் இண்டிவிஜுவல் பட் கேன் பி வயலேட்டட் பை அ ஹோல் நேஷன். டோன்ட் ஃபர்கெட் திஸ், பிகாஸ் த ஹோல் நேஷன் டாலரேட்ஸ் எக்ஸ்ட்ரீம் பவர்ட்டி, where there are people who don't have access to good water and good air sometimes, and they don't have no control. So I want you to understand where violation ethics takes place. Are you clear? So then you can come to survival. Survival, the first breathing, I'm now going fast. Next action for human beings is sleeping, in case you don't know. Next most important action is sleeping. அதுக்கு பிறகு டாக்டர் இருக்காரு, அதுக்கு அப்புறம் தான் வாட்டர். Okay, after sleeping comes water. You know why? Because time is very important. If you don't have air, how long will you survive? அவ்வளவுதான். சரி, வேர்ல்ட் ரெக்கார்ட் வேணாலும் வச்சுக்கோங்க. ஹலோ யோ, இட்ஸ் அ மேட்டர் ஆஃப் மினிட்ஸ். அக்ரி? இஃப் யூ டோன்ட் ஹேவ் ஸ்லீப், நீங்க நெட்ல தேடி பார்க்கலாம், ஒரு 50-60 மணி நேரம், 50-60 hours of continuous lack of sleep, you first lose control over your mind, hallucination வந்துடும். அப்புறம் நெட்டில் நான் பண்ண பார்த்த இன்ஃபர்மேஷன், ஜென்ரலாக, ஐ மீன் நாட் டாக் வேர்ல்ட் ரெக்கார்ட்ஸ் இயர், ஆர்டினரிலி 100-120 ஹவர்ஸ் ரிஸ்க் ஆஃப் கார்டியாக் அரெஸ்ட் இஸ் வெரி ஹை விதவுட் கண்டினியூஸ் லேக் ஆஃப் ஸ்லீப். வாட்டர் 5-7 நாள் கூட போகும் உங்களுக்கு, தாக்கு பிடிக்கலாம் தண்ணியே இல்லாமல். ஃபுட் அப்புறம் தான், யூனோ யூ கேன் ரன் ஃபார் குவைட் சம் டைம் விதவுட் ப்ராப்பர் நியூட்ரிஷன், மோர் தென் வாட்டர். ஸோ அதெல்லாம் காமன். Now, these resources, action, experience, and conditions, we can classify as vital, essential, and desirable. VED. Vital, essential, and desirable. So, this row itself, I can split into 3 sub-rows. I hope you got it. Where the top sub-row is vital, vital resources, action, experience, conditions. By the way, this is a combination. This is a combination. You are utilizing resources, you are performing action experiences under some conditions for fulfilling basic aims. This is the story of our lives, and this is where the game of ethics starts. I'm coming very close now. Please spare me a little more time. Please. Okay. Please spare me a little more time. Okay. Now we'll come. Have you understood this vital, essential, desirable? Any resource, action, experience, or condition without which you cannot fulfill the basic aim, impossible, that is vital. Can you fulfill the basic aim without air? Without air, can you survive? Cannot. Vital. Now we'll come to essential. Any resource, action, experience, or condition without which you can fulfill the basic aim, but with reduced quality. That is essential. Quality poido. Very good example. Where will you place physical exercise? It's an action experience. You use resources. For example, I went for a walk. Your campus is a resource for me for my walking. I hope you got it. So I use resources. I perform action experience. There is a condition. It was nice and cool and a little humid. So I did my survival job for the morning when I went for my walk. And that has some beneficial effects on me, obviously, because my heart rate goes up subtly. And you know, when the heart rate is raised, elevated a little bit, the rest of the day is a little comfortable. So all these things are known in medical science, isn't it? So physical exercise is essential. Why? If I do not do physical exercise, will I stop surviving? I'll survive. But what will happen to the quality of my survival? Doubt. So essential. Desirable. இருந்தா நல்லது இல்லைனா ஒன்றும் பிரச்சனை இல்லை. பட் வை திஸ் இஸ் டைனமிக். மை வாட்ச் இஸ் டிசைரபிள். ஓகே, இட் கேன் ஹெல்ப் மீ இன் மை சர்வைவல். ஐ வாஸ் ஜஸ்ட் டெல்லிங் சங்கர் இன் த மார்னிங், ஐ வாஸ் ஃபோர்ஸ் டு பை திஸ் வாட்ச் பை மை ஃப்ரெண்ட். பட் ஓகே, ஐ எம் அக்செப்டிங் இட், பிகாஸ் திஸ் வாட்ச் கேன் டெல் மீ இஃப் ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு கெட் அ ஸ்ட்ரோக் ஆர் நாட். ஓகே, யா ஆ யா 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 அது தட்ஸ் இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங். ராம் சார் சொன்ன, நோ வெரி இன்ட்ரெஸ்டிங் வாட்ச். எனக்கே மை கிராண்ட் சைல்ட் கேம் ரன்னிங் டு மீ அண்ட் ஷி ஜம்ப்ட் ஆன் மீ. எங்கள் வீட்டில் நடந்தது சார், ஜஸ்ட் லாஸ்ட் மந்த். அண்ட் தென் த வாட்ச் செட் பீப் 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 பீப். என்னடான்னு பார்த்தானக்கா, ப்ரொஃபஸர் கணேஷ், அதில் சிக்னல் வருது, பிகாஸ் ஐ ரெஜிஸ்டர்ட் மை நேம். நோ ப்ரொஃபஸர் கணேஷ், யூ மே ஹவ் ஹேட் அ ஃபால், ஷுட் ஐ கால் எமர்ஜென்சி? வாட்ச் சொல்றது, கேன் ஐ கால் எமர்ஜென்சி பிகாஸ் மை கிராண்ட் டாட்டர் ஜம்ப்ட் ஆன் மீ? நோ. So immediately the watch sensed that something had has up, some instability in this person. So shall I call emergency? Okay, it's very interesting. So anyway, desirable. You know, in the watch illana onnum prachana illa, but irunda it's some advantage. That's desirable. So any resource, action, experience or condition with which I'll get some functionality, without which no problem, is desirable. So you know, vital, essential, desirable. So you can play this full game. I'm not taking you into mental side, but I can. Okay, we have to see mental survival. Enna pannalanu. The next basic aim is stability. Again, VED, stability. Stable survival. Sthiramana vaalvu. Physically and mentally. And remember, mental stability is even more important because it gets disturbed very fast, very fast. Suppose I'm searching for a candle when lights have gone off. The candle becomes essential at that time. And you don't get that candle, your mental stability is disturbed a bit. You know, for some people, not watching a serial on the TV could destabilize them, isn't it? Some other people, something can destabilize. So loss of stability doesn't mean loss of mind. I'm not talking of that extreme. I'm talking of disturbance happening in our mind. You're destabilized. It can be on the positive side. You can be very happy, elated, and you can be destabilized. Or you can be sad or confused, which is destabilized. That is the thing. So stability, VED, adhe resources, ellam varum inge. Moona of the basic aim, strength. I hope you got it. Now, these three basic aims, there are three more: success, superiority, and sustainability. You can note it. There are three more basic aims of human life: survival, stability, strength, success, superiority, and sustainability. In the R basic aims is something that we seek individually and collectively. I hope you got it. Individually and collectively, we seek these basic aims. Why did I come to this? Here is the answer. That is our purpose. It is your purpose to survive. It is your purpose to seek a stable life. It is your purpose to become strong. It is your purpose to succeed, but while following the codes of morals and ethics within that frame. I hope you got it. individually and collectively. It is the purpose of PSG iTech to survive. I hope you got it. It is the purpose of PSG iTech to be stable. Institution also has to be stable, no? It's not just the individual. So like that, you have many conditions under which we are operating. So I hope you got this. Survival, stability, strength, success, superiority, and sustainability. This is the game that we are playing in which ethics happens. Is this clear, sir? So now you can ask me, what is ethics? And I'm going to answer that question, and I will close in 5 minutes exactly. Okay? Can I rub this off, sir? Can you help me? Ah, parala, onnul. No problems. Yeah. Okay, done. Now, how do we judge whether something is ethical or not? Inga vandu, we have to quickly understand morals, ethics, values, traditions, laws, religion. Because ethics can be violated across all these things. Morals, ethics, values, traditions, laws, and religion. Please understand, these need not be consistent. Namma naatle paathutom nama, there is no consistency between religion and law. I hope you got it. Not just in our country, many countries. There is no consistency between religion and law. It can be different. But you don't get into the territory. That's a territory where you work as a human being and try to solve matters. Don't put on any hat. Don't put on a hat that I'm an Indian, or I'm a Chinese, or I'm a Brahmin, or I'm a Roman Catholic. That doesn't work. First, you're a human being. Other labels come later. Isn't it? Neither the sperm nor the egg knows what label is going to come. Let's be clear about that. Okay? So let's be clear about that. Okay, fine. How do we judge ethics? Ethics is judged in terms of violations of these things which I told you. Violations. Okay? In some manner or the other. So we'll draw a simple scale which you can all use. And it's especially good for our students. I have this simple scale. The first part of the scale, which goes from right to left, usually nama graph alone left to right poduvom, this is purposely drawn right to left. The first part we will call as error. Second part we'll call as mistake. And the third part we'll call as sin. So violations of ethics can be classified as error, mistake, or sin. And each one has two small parts. Small error, major blunder. Error, a minor error, major blunder. You can call it minor error, major blunder. Adhe mari, mistake can be classified. These are all violations. Mistake can be classified as small mistake, big catastrophe. Edhinikkingla? Minor error, major blunder. Small mistake, big catastrophe. Ordinary sin, cardinal sin. Pavam, mahapavam. I hope you got it. Okay, great. Now let's see what these are. Very quickly, we are going to use certain criteria to classify our experiences. Intention and knowledge. When you commit an undesirable or painful act without intention and without knowledge, you are committing an error. I hope this is clear. நோக்கும் கிடையாது, ஞானமும் கிடையாது, விழிப்புணர்வும் இல்லை. You're committing an error. Okay, small error. At least what most of us will classify as small error. Okay, it's unethical but very minor. You hurt yourself. இங்கே நடந்துட்டு இருக்கீங்க, டபால்னு முட்டிண்டு கொஞ்சம் பேந்துகிறது. யூ ஹர்ட் யுவர் செல்ஃப். இஸ் யுவர் பர்பஸ் டு ஹர்ட் யுவர் செல்ஃப்? நோ. இஸ் யுவர் பர்பஸ் டு ப்ரொடெக்ட் யுவர் செல்ஃப்? டிட் யூ ப்ரொடெக்ட் யுவர் செல்ஃப்? ஸ்மால் எரர். ஐ ஹோப் யூ காட் இட். இஸ் இட் கிளியர் சார்? ஸ்மால் எரர், ஏதோ ஸ்மால் ஹர்ட் தெரியாம, பிகாஸ் யூ நைதர் ஹேட் இன்டென்ஷன் நார் ஹேட் நாலேஜ், தெரியாமல் நடந்துருத்தது அவ்வளோதான். வி டூ தட் ஆஃபன். சில சமயம் கதவுக்கு நடுவில் கையை வச்சு நம்மளே சாத்திப்போம். அது ஹேப்பன்ட் ஆர் நாட் ஒன்ஸ் ஆர் ட்வைஸ். ஸ்மால் எரர், பிக் பிளண்டர் ஆர் மைனர் எரர், மேஜர் பிளண்டர். ஓகே, மேஜர் பிளண்டர். ஐ திங்க் மெனி ஆஃப் யூ வில் ரிமெம்பர் த ட்ரிச்சி பிளைண்ட் ட்ராஜடி சம் இயர்ஸ் அகோ. டாக்டர் உட்னோ 32 பேர் ஐ கேம்புக்கு போய் குருடாயிட்டு வந்தாங்க வெளில. இஸ் அ மேஜர் பிளண்டர் பை த டாக்டர்ஸ். பட் வாஸ் தேர் இன்டென்ஷன் டு மேக் தம் பிளைண்ட்? நோ. டிட் தே ஹாவ் நாலேஜ் தட் தேவர் மேக்கிங் தம் பிளைண்ட்? நோ. பட் நடந்துருது. தட்ஸ் அ வேர்ல்ட்லி ட்ரூத். அவ்வளோதான். அவங்க என்னத்தாலையும் நினைச்சு பார்க்க மாட்டாங்க. அஃப்கோர்ஸ் வேர் தே சேட், தேர் டெரிபிளி சேட். வை? Somebody else did a sin. அதில் இவங்க collateral damage. இவங்க these doctors are collateral damage. They are innocent. அவங்க பார்த்தாங்க எல்லாம் மெடிசன் கரெக்டாக, எக்ஸ்பைரி டேட் எல்லாம் கரெக்டாக இருக்கு. அப்ளை. தட் மீன்ஸ் த டாக்டர் ஹஸ் ஆக்டட் இன் குட் ஃபெய்த். ஐ ஹோப் யூ காட் இட். எல்லாம் கரெக்டாக இருக்கு, அப்ளை பண்ணியாச்சு. பட் 32 பீப்புள் ஆர் பிளைண்ட் ஃபார் லைஃப். மேஜர் பிளண்டர், கரெக்டாக. ஆனால் எவனும் பாவம் பண்ணியிருக்கான், டாக்டர் இல்லை. I hope you got it. As far as the doctor is concerned, it was a major blunder. Okay? Because even if they are taken to court, any sane judge would say, look, I mean, you can't be doing testing every bloody medicine every time. You have to trust the label somewhere. Apparently, but doctors will not be able to cure that way. Okay? So major blunder. Are you clear, sir? Something undesirable happened on a large scale? Yes, major blunder. Intention irundhada? Illa. Knowledge இருந்ததா? இல்லை. நெக்ஸ்ட் மிஸ்டேக், இன்டென்ஷன், நாலெட்ஜ். நாலெட்ஜ் இருக்கா? இருக்கு. இன்டென்ஷன் இருக்கா? இல்லை. ஸ்மால் மிஸ்டேக், பிக் கேட்டாஸ்ட்ரஃபி. எக்ஸாம்பிள், ஸ்மால் மிஸ்டேக், யூ ஆர் வெயிட்டிங் அட் த பஸ் ஸ்டாண்ட், லாட் ஆஃப் பீப்புள் ஆர் தேர், தேர் இஸ் நோ க்யூ. உள்ளே போகிறதுக்கு என்ன பண்ணுவீங்க? கமான், what do we normally do? Anybody putna panuvingala illaya? Is your intention to hurt the other person? Unga nokada kutra avana, is that the intention which you are doing? No. But do you have knowledge you are nudging or not? Pandringa ngiradha knowledge iruka illaya ungalku? Sollunga. You have knowledge but you don't have intention. You are making a mistake. It's not an error anymore. For all you know, the person you nudge may be an old lady or a child. You don't know. Because what is your intention? Naa ulla ponom, bus ulla, and modalla ponom. Isn't it? That's the intention with which things happen. So that's a mistake. Are we clear, sir? Are you clear about minor mistake? It's no longer an error. Why? You know that you are nudging. You can't say you don't know. You can't say breathing mari involuntary action la solla mudiyad. Come on, come on. Nobody is going to buy that. Major catastrophe, small mistake, big catastrophe. Endha shuttle sir burst aachu? Colombia va idva? Kalpana Chawla ponadhu Colombia. Big catastrophe. Or 8 or 9 astronauts fat outer atmosphere la. Yeah. Was the intention to kill them? No. But was there knowledge of the risk? Yes. There was knowledge of the risk. If this is an engineering case study, you can check this, of system failure. It's a fantastic case study. How the Columbia shuttle, I hope it's Columbia, I hope I'm not wrong. Sometimes my general knowledge may fail me. We lost astronauts. But there was knowledge that something, and the heat shield, according to one line, one storyline that I had accessed, it was that the heat shield that was on the surface of the shuttle came off. And the rest is tragic history. because you know at re-entry speeds what will happen. And the friction, boom, poch, big catastrophe. So knowledge was there, intention was not there. I hope you got this example. Ordinary sin, cardinal sin. உங்களுக்கே தெரியும் என்ன ஈக்குவேஷன் வரப்போகுதுன்னு. நாலெட்ஜும் இருக்கு, இன்டென்ஷனும் இருக்கு. நான் ஹார்ம் பண்ணுறோங்கிற இன்டென்ஷனும் இருக்கு, நாலெட்ஜும் இருக்கு. தட்ஸ் வை வி சே ஆர்டினரி சின் அண்ட் கார்டினல் சின். ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள், டேக்கிங் அவே அ லைஃப் ஆர் டிஸ்ட்ராயிங் த டிக்னிட்டி ஆஃப் அ பர்சன் வில்ஃபுல்லி அண்ட் வித் நாலெட்ஜ் இஸ் அ சின். பாவம் அது. ஐ ஹோப் யூ காட் இட். And you can judge. Please, my dear friends and all my students, you are the best judge of your action. That's why I'm giving you the scale. You know whether you know or you don't know in a situation. You know whether your intention is there or not. Don't give me this bull that you don't know. And you know whether you're attempting harm or attempting to support. Every one of us knows that. So, ஒரு தனி நபரையோ, ஒரு குடும்பத்தையோ, ஒரு சமுதாயத்தையோ வேணும்னே நான் அழிக்கப்படுவேன். Willfully, bagirangama, when I am going to harm or destroy, I am committing a sin. I am not committing a good act. And don't give me any bull that you are committing a good act. Because destruction is not your right anyway. Argumentation is your right. Upholding principles is your right. Upholding your thoughts is your right. You argue out. But don't harm. That is the story. I hope you got it. This is the simple scale which any individual can use to judge whether his or her actions are ethical or unethical. I'll ask you a simple question. When I drink alcohol, thanni adigiren naan, is it ethical or unethical? I've given you a scale. Now you tell me. Use the frame. I've given you the answers on the board. Just apply the principles that I've told you now. தண்ணி அடிக்கிறேன்னா அது அது இன்டென்ஷனை பொறுத்து இருக்கு. இஃப் மை இன்டென்ஷன் இஸ் டு ஹார்ம் த ஃபேமிலி, அது சின். புரிஞ்சீங்களா? அதர்வைஸ் இட் கேன் பி அ பிக் மிஸ்டேக், ஐ மீன் பிக் கேட்டாஸ்ட்ரஃபி. ஐ ஹோப் யூ காட் இட் மேன். மை இன்டென்ஷன் இஸ் நாட் டு ஹார்ம் த ஃபேமிலி. வாட் இஸ் மை இன்டென்ஷன்? ஐ மஸ்ட் ஃபீல் அவுட் ஆஃப் த பெயின் ஆஃப் த வேர்ல்ட். பட் த ப்ராப்ளம் இஸ், in the short term I am drinking for mental stability. Correct, ma'am? I am drinking. The alcohol becomes a, please understand, the alcohol becomes vital resource for short term mental stability. But when I do that again and again, do you agree I am hurting my long term survival? This is the danger of human beings. This is the contradiction that all of us live with. I want to show this பகிரங்கமாக உங்களுக்கு காட்டணும். அதை எது நல்லதுன்னு ஷார்ட் டேர்மில் நினச்சி நம்மளை குதிக்கிறோமோ, தட் கேன் ஹார்ம் அஸ் இன் த லாங் ரன். அதனால்தான் யோசிச்சு பண்ணுன்னு சொல்கிறோம். நம்ம எதாக இருந்தாலும் லுக் அட் போத் தி ஷார்ட் டேர்ம் கான்சிக்வன்சஸ் அண்ட் த லாங் டேர்ம் கான்சிக்வன்சஸ். யூ கேன் சே லாங் டேர்ம் வி ஆர் டயிங். கம் ஆன் யார், தட்ஸ் நாட் இன் யுவர் ஹேண்ட்ஸ் ஆர் மை ஹேண்ட்ஸ். சூயிசைட் இஸ் இன் யுவர் ஹேண்ட்ஸ். பட் ரிமெம்பர், பை எனி ரிலிஜன் ஆர் பை எனி ஸ்பிரிச்சுவல் டிஸ்கோர்ஸ், suicide is a cardinal sin. Please understand that. Suicide is a cardinal sin. Sir, na settu pona appuram enna nu solla nee? Adukku religions give different answers. Different religions give different answers. If you take Christianity or Islam, judgment day okaruvaanga. If you take Hinduism, machani thirumbi varuva, return varum, karmic theory. You know, the Hinduism says that you will come back, your karma, you'll have to bear your karma. Don't think you can escape. Why? Because you can never become nothing. You are always something. So something has to continue. And there are rules for that continuation, which are the karmic laws. So the theories are different. But the point is, it's a cardinal sin. Suicide is a cardinal sin. Cheating your parents is a cardinal sin. Cutting classes with the intention to cut the class is an ordinary sin. I hope you got it, my dear students. With the intention to cut the class, thimuru cutting class, adu vandu ordinary sin. But if you cut the class for some other reason, let's say one of your student, fellow students is sick, you did not have the time to tell the teacher or the principal, you have taken the fellow to the hospital, actually you are doing a dharmic act, which even the principal will condone. Because it was not your intention to cut the class, you may have had the knowledge, so even that will be turned into a dharmic act. Because you are engaging something noble for the benefit of another. Please understand, when you live your life for the survival, stability, strength, success, superiority, sustainability of other people, you are a noble person. மற்றவங்க நலத்துக்கு நீ வரும்போது யூ ஆர் ஆட்டோமேட்டிக்கலி நோபிள். ப்ளீஸ் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் திஸ். யூ நாட் பிளேயிங் இட் ஃபார் யுவர் செல்ஃப். ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் த கேம். ஐ ஹவ் ஃபினிஷ்ட். ஐ எம் ஜஸ்ட் கோயிங் டு கிவ் யூ ஒன் லாஸ்ட் அனெக்டோட் அண்ட் வி ஆர் க்ளோசிங். இஸ் மை ஃபேவரட் அனெக்டோட் விச் ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ வில் என்ஜாய் ஆஸ் அதர் ஆடியன்ஸ் ஹவ் ஏர்லியர். திஸ் இஸ் ஃப்ரம் த மகாபாரத. அண்ட் இட்ஸ் அ ஃபேண்டாஸ்டிக் அனெக்டோட் பிகாஸ் இட்ஸ் ஸோ பியூட்டிஃபுல். இட் இஸ் இன் டூ பார்ட்ஸ். First part, both are after the Kurukshetra war. The first part consists of a brief conversation between Yudhishthira and Krishna. So Yudhishthira vande, he sees the war field, and he is a good person. Character is good. He is a nice person, Dharmaputra. So he is seeing, and his heart is torn. He is such a good man. He is sensitive. He asks Krishna, Krishna, is this what I fought for? Almost, according to history, Ashoka felt after the Kalinga war, idhukku dhaan na sanda poten. He started asking that fundamental question. Did I fight for this? Do I want so many dead bodies around me? Do I want so many widows around me? Do you want orphan children with me? That's not what I fought for. So Ashoka transforms. Adhe maari anga Yudhishthira kekkarar Krishna, Krishna idhukku dhaan na sanda poten. Did I fight for this? I'm very saddened and depressed by what I'm seeing. Then Krishna, he asked a question, Krishna, if Dwapara Yuga is going to be so bad, is so bad, how will Kali Yuga be? He asks a question. So Krishna gives two answers. First answer is, in Kali Yuga, people will commit infinitesimally small errors, mistakes and sins that they don't even know what the hell is happening, but they will realize later. So siruga siruga indha mari paavam panni dhaan Kali Yugam. Muttu. That's the character of Kali Yuga. That's what I am telling you. That is first. Second answer is phenomenal. He says, in Tamil, I'll translate in English for everybody there in the audience who may not know. Kali Yugatla thai seyai namba mudiyadhu, sey thaiyai namba mudiyadhu. Cryptic answer, actually. Our cryptography. It's a cryptic answer. He says, mother cannot trust child, child cannot trust mother. That will be the character of Kali Yuga. Now, I hope we got the message. It will be such a bad time for human existence that that will be the state of affairs. Yada yada hi dharmasya. So he says, then I will come and I will redeem the world for everybody. Because ultimately, satyameva jayate. Dharma should prevail ultimately. Okay, so that is the two things. But then follows the climax. Ashwatthama is the only surviving warrior from the Kauravas side. He is Dronacharya's son. And he is livid, absolutely enraged by what has happened. I mean, his own father's murder, that to Poisolli, you know that, no? And Poiyar Sunanga, Yudhishthira, of all people, Avar Poisolli, he is just unable to control himself. He is totally enraged. And everybody is dead around him. He is the only guy surviving. And on the kovatla vandu, he takes off his Brahmastra and releases the Brahmastra to put an end to all the Pandavas. And according to mythology, Brahmastra is the most powerful weapon of war. Krishna sees Ashwatthama releasing the Brahmastra. Idu ethics kaga solra. Krishna sees Ashwatthama releasing the Brahmastra and immediately warns Arjuna, the only way you guys can stop destruction is you take your Brahmastra and leave it against Ashwatthama's Brahmastra. That's the only way you guys will survive. Otherwise, you may not survive. Arjuna, being a faithful student and disciple of Krishna, Brahmastra eduthu uttirrar. According to the mythological one variation of the story, the Brahmastra's clash and all hell breaks loose. When two brahmastras clash, you can imagine what will happen. Okay, it's just imagination. And the vara patha devargal, gandharvargal, kinnargal, all the people, all the other sentient beings in the heavens and on earth or wherever, padalavanga, ellarum vantanga, Krishna kitta. And they are saying, Krishna, the fight is between the Kauravas and the Pandavas. Why the hell are you doing something which is harming us? எங்களுக்கும் உங்களுக்கும் சம்பந்தமே கிடையாதுயா. We don't have anything to do with your fight. Why the hell are you doing something which is harming us? So Krishna says, yeah, fair. He calls Ashwatthama and Arjuna and says, what do you have to say? Because what you are, you two are doing is harming other innocent people. Because there's a long conversation. Then ultimately, Ashwatthama tells Krishna, Krishna, I respect you. Whatever it may be, I may not agree with you, but I respect you. You tell me what I should do. Then Krishna tells Arjuna and Ashwatthama, please recall your weapons. Recall your brahmastras. Arjuna, being the faithful disciple and friend, withdraws. Ashwatthama thalaya soriyaran. He's scratching his head. And Krishna asks, what? What are you doing? Ashwatthama says, I don't know how to recall. And Krishna says, you fool. Why did you engage in an action knowing that you are not in full control or at least reasonable control of what you're going to do? Enna pannanone theriyama yenda poonda action la. And there's another argument, and Ashwatthama says, look, idella udu in Tamil Madras bhasha ipo enna angra. What do you want me to do now? You tell me, I will follow. Then Krishna gives a fantastic decision criterion which is even valid today. If that mythology is true, it's valid even today. He tells Ashwatthama, you direct that brahmastra to a place where the maximum damage will be minimized. It's called the mini-max criterion in decision theory. The maximum damage should be minimized. Okay, I hope you got it. Was Ashwatthama's intention to destroy? Did Ashwatthama intend to destroy? Come on. Did he have knowledge of what will happen with the brahmastra? Yes. Intention irundhudu, knowledge irundhudu. And he was seeking massive destruction. Cardinal sin. Please understand this. I'm applying this and telling you. He was committing cardinal sin. So then Ashwatthama directs that brahmastra yenga. He directs that brahmastra to kill Parikshit, the baby, the fetus, still in the womb of Uttara, the widow of Abhimanyu. Krishna sees this, and of course, Krishna being Krishna by the mythology, he stops the damage. And then he asks Ashwatthama, "Innaya pandra, what are you doing? You are taking the brahmastra to kill a yet-to-be-born baby. What kind of a warrior are you?" Big argument again between the two. Because Ashwatthama also has a point. Yo, nee poi solla solli thana Yudhishthira poi solla. Nee no periya ivan mari pesre. And he asked Krishna, you're talking as though you're a saint. You're not. You're the rascal who told Yudhishthira to tell a lie to my father. And that's why my father was killed. What kind of nonsense are you talking? Avan kekran Krishna ra. Of course, that argument goes on and on. You know that, no? Then Krishna finally asks, I'm going to ask you some questions. This is the climax. I'm going to ask you some questions and you answer these questions, Ashwatthama. That's all. First, do you agree that the war was formally closed? Ashwatthama says, yes, the war was formally closed. The bugles were blown and the shank was blown. All of us know the war was. Do you know that after a war is closed, you cannot wield a weapon? Dharmically, you cannot wield a weapon. He says, yes, I know you cannot wield a weapon. This part is over. Next part. Do you know that wielding a weapon after the war is closed is a mahapavam? He says, yes, I know. Do you know that deploying the brahmastra is not allowed in any war, under any condition? Please note, according to the mythology, brahmastra is only a weapon of threat, not a weapon of deployment. I hope you got it. Nee enna solla dabar engaila irukke vechukada. That's all you can say. Look, I mean, I have this weapon with me, don't play the fool with me. It's only a weapon of threat, not a weapon of deployment. You did that. He says, yes, I know that. So you did deploy the Brahmastra. Yes. You deployed the Brahmastra after the war was over. Yes. Did you deploy the Brahmastra to kill a yet-to-be-born baby? Still in the womb of its mother, Parikshit. He says, yes. Why did you do that? Adhuk badal sulrari, Ashwatthama. I know that was the last seed of the Pandavas. There are no more Pandavas after Parikshit. Ivangala vayasai poiduvaanga ellarum. No more Pandavas after that. And my revenge will be complete then. He is giving an excuse. He is justifying his action. He says, my war with the Pandavas will be perfectly done when that child is no more. So no more Pandavas. No more Kauravas, no more Pandavas. We are even. Adutha janmathila paathukalam. You know. So it's like that. Then Krishna asks, okay, fine. You have said that. Now let me go back one step. First, do you agree the Brahmastra was actually sent, directed at a woman? Uttara. He thinks and says, yes, it was directed at a woman because the child is inside the, in the womb of the woman. So I have to destroy the child, I have to destroy the woman. So you sent a weapon, the biggest, strongest, most potent weapon to attack a woman. First point. Second point, did you send that Brahmastra at a woman who is not at war with you? She is not fighting with you. Ashwatthama thinks, oh yes, I sent it, I directed it to a woman who is not at war with me. I agree. Checkmate, Krishna's checkmate now. Did you send the Brahmastra to a woman who is not at war with you? And who does not know that she is being attacked? He doesn't even know that she is being attacked. What kind? Then he says, yes. And then Krishna says, and you are a warrior. Nee vandu unna veeranu solikirani. Ashwatthama thalaiya thonga potrar. He is not able to bear the logic of Krishna's arguments. He hangs his head in shame. Then Krishna gives him a curse. He says, Ashwatthama, I am going to curse you. My first curse, you will live forever. You won't die. Unakku saavu kadaiyadu. Namakkellam punyam nanichupom. Punyam illa. Adutathu rider paarenga. You will never know inner peace while you exist. Aalndha amaidina enna unakku enna ne theriyadu. Andha vaalkaiye nee nirandharama vaalva abindrar. My dear friends, this is the worst curse anybody can get. You cannot think of a worse curse. And this story is told when we discuss ethics because our belief is Ashwatthama is sitting in one of the unoccupied chairs listening to his own story. So avanukku mana amaidiye kadaiyadu enna adha kadai yaro sollite irupanga avanukku nyabagapaduthirukku because he did such an act. It's an unimaginably evil act. And why this story is told in Kali Yuga, there's another reason. Dwapara Yugathiliye andha mari oru karyathukku, for that kind of an action in Dwapara Yuga, Ashwatthama gave an excuse. The corollary for Kali Yuga is any excuse will do. Namaste, thank you very much. Thank you, students. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah. Thanks for bearing with me, but I hope I was of some use to you this morning. Yeah.